Welcome to Web Servers and Clients, the section where we learn the fundamental skills needed to build robust HTTP servers and clients. Here's what we'll cover. We'll ease in by building and deconstructing a simple web server to help us get familiar with the NET HTTP package, then look at a more complete example to further solidify our understanding. We'll see how to augment our HTTP handlers to perform actions before and after each request and cut down on repetition using techniques to create what are typically referred to as middleware. We'll build a client that consumes from HTTP servers and look at some ways for preventing a slow server from hanging our client indefinitely. We'll then come back to building servers that are more resilient to client cancellations and long-running processes using the context package. Let's get started. Hi, and welcome to Build a Simple Server with NET HTTP, where we learn how to build an HTTP server using nothing but the standard library. I will assume that you already have a solid foundation on how the request response model of the web works, and that you are familiar with the use of HTTP verbs, requests, and response bodies, etc. In this video, we'll cover the handling of incoming HTTP requests, routing of our requests, and also touch on how multiplexers come into play when we need to go beyond the defaults we get out of the box for routing. Let's start with handling incoming requests by diving right into this example, which actually shows a complete working HTTP server in Go. In our main function, we start by making use of the HTTP package's handle function to handle incoming HTTP requests to the root of our server, designated by the slash pattern. Looking at the documentation for handle func, we know that the function that will be invoked when a request comes into that route must accept an HTTP response writer and a pointer to an HTTP request. We'll talk more about those soon. Back in our main, we emit something to send it out as an indication that the server is starting. To start the server, we make use of the HTTP listen and serve function, which takes a TCP network address, in this case our loopback address, along with a port. Listen and serve takes a second argument. This nil is an indication to use the HTTP package's default request multiplexer behind the scenes, something we'll discuss soon. Listen and serve could fail, so we wrap the call inside of a log statement to let us know if something goes wrong. Unlike our previous programs that simply ran through their operations and exited, once our current program reaches this point, it will simply wait to receive requests and only stop when we tell it to. Let's see our server in action. When our logging statement is emitted, we know the server is ready to accept requests. I'll leave my program running in this terminal and open another one where I can send some requests. I'll make use of the curl utility to issue a GET request to the root of the server. And that works. Changing the request path also yields the same output, but we knew that would happen since we had our handler func accept all requests starting at the root. Handle func is one way of registering functions to handle incoming requests. The other way is to use handle. This function will accept a pattern, just like handle func. But unlike handle func, it will accept a value that implements the HTTP handler interface instead. To satisfy this interface, a value needs to have a serve HTTP function that accepts a response writer and a pointer to a request. That looks awfully similar to the signature of functions we provide to the handle func, doesn't it? Well, you're not seeing double. It is the same. Behind the scenes, the handle func function simply makes sure to convert your function appropriately into something that satisfies the handler interface. Let's actually create a handler. In this example, we're declaring a greet handler struct and attaching to that a serve HTTP function, which takes a response writer and a request, thereby meeting the requirements for the HTTP handler interface. We then use the handle function to register the slash greet pattern and route requests to the greet handler. The positioning of the root path handler is deliberate here, because we want it to be the last one to be evaluated. When we run our program, our root handler still works, and our new greet handler is working as well. Now that we know the bare minimum needed to have a server, let's expand on that to write something a little more interesting. We're adding a new handler to handle the slash proverbs route. This handler's job will be to impart wise words from a set of Go proverbs. We obtained this handler through this new proverbs handler call, so let's take a peek at it. The function is pretty straightforward. It returns a pointer to a proverbs handler, a custom type with an underlying struct that contains a list of proverbs, each being a struct with an ID and value fields. To be an HTTP handler, a proverbs handler must expose a serve HTTP function, and that's what we have here. What we do inside of this method is try to determine which proverb, if any, that the client has asked for. To do that, we need to interrogate the incoming requests. Let's look up the documentation for this. An HTTP request encapsulates everything there is to know about an incoming request, including its method, URL, headers, body, etc. Using that knowledge, we look at the request URL's path to determine what ID was passed in after the pattern that triggered this handler in the first place using this slice operation. If we're unable to convert what we find to an int for whatever reason, we'll respond to the client with an HTTP status of 400 bad requests. Note the return statement here, because we don't want anything else attempting to perform additional writes using this writer. If we successfully obtain an integer, we'll then look up the proverb using that ID. You can probably guess what the lookup method does. We range over our list of proverbs, checking if we have a match on the ID we collected back in the handler. If we do, we return a pointer to our proverb, otherwise we return nil, and an error indicating that we did not find a match. Note how we predefined this error variable, which we then use back in our serve HTTP method for comparison. Should there be no match for the ID sent in, we'll use the status not found error code predefined in the HTTP package to respond to the client, this time using the HTTP error function, which takes a response writer, error string, and HTTP status code. By the way, you can find a complete list of the HTTP status codes defined as constants in the package. If we manage to get to the end of the handler, that means we have a proverb to work with, and we use the fprintln here to return the value. fprintln takes an IO writer, and the response writer satisfies that interface perfectly. With this write, we're also implicitly returning a status of 200 OK back to the client. Let's run our program. Now that our server has started, we can issue a few requests to see how the different use cases we accounted for in our code come into play. First, we'll specify a proverb's path that we know cannot successfully yield a valid ID. We get a 400 bad request status back, and this lines up with the first scenario we are handling in proverbs handler. So far, so good. Next, we'll specify an ID we know doesn't exist. Here, we see that we got back a 404 not found, as we specified in our failed lookup scenario. Next, we'll specify a known proverb ID and see what comes back. It works. We can try this for any number of proverbs we know to be in our list and get a successful response back. Now let's try one last thing. If we look at the routes we're handling, we see that we have a trailing slash on the proverbs pattern. What happens when we make a request without that trailing slash? That's weird since we didn't write anything like this in our code. How come? Well, it turns out that the default serve mux that we're using provides this capability out of the box. You might naturally be asking next, what's a serve mux? The serve mux is an HTTP request multiplexer that matches the URL of each incoming request against a list of registered patterns and calls the handler for the pattern that most closely matches the URL. That's exactly what we've been doing when using handle and handle func in our example. By using handle and handle func, however, note that you did not have to attach them to a serve mux variable anywhere. When you use handle and handle func, you're making use of a default serve mux that the HTTP package makes available out of the box. This is simply a matter of the Go standard library making the experience of getting up and running with the NetHTTP package as painless as possible by predefining that serve mux for you and enabling some default behavior like the 301 redirect we just saw. You can create and customize your own multiplexer when you have the need to by simply ensuring that it implements the HTTP handler interface, meaning having it expose a serve HTTP method that accepts a response writer and a pointer to a request. Let's see an example of that. We start out with a struct that we then attach a serve HTTP to. Inside of this method, we're taking care of our own routing and choosing to only honor a slash greet pattern with a response and returning a 404 not found to all others. In our main, we can see how we're no longer using a handle or handle func to set up routing, but rather create a new muxer that we then provide as a second argument to listen and serve, replacing the nil we've been seeing up to this point. When we test our program, the root path gets a 404 as would any path other than slash greet. And voila, your own request multiplexer, albeit a limited one. You are likely to come across a wide variety of multiplexers and routers throughout the Go ecosystem, so do feel free to explore what they have to offer. That said, you can go a long way with the standard library without having to use any third-party muxers or web frameworks. In this video, we covered significant ground in learning how to work with the NetHTTP package to create a web server. We cover different ways of routing our requests to appropriate handlers, learn how to interrogate incoming requests for data, got to understand what the default servbox is, some of the behavior we get out of the box, and how to create our own request multiplexer.